Afternoon, wherever you are in the world, welcome to CodeBeam V. I'm Erik Sjön, your track host, heading up Airline Solutions in the Nordics. And I'm happy to introduce Mark Worrell, creator of Zotonic, the airline content management system, doing everything from social websites to generating assemblers for embedded systems. So extensive experience here. And we will hear more about the Cotonic, the browser coroutines with the MQTT message bus. So, you know, Erlang to JavaScript, this will be super exciting. Questions, you can ask them in the Hoover app during the talk, and then we will pick them one by one afterwards. So without further ado, Mark, please take it away.
Hey, Erik, thank you. I assume everybody can hear me. If not, then you can complain at Erik because he tested it before. So I will tell a bit about our adventures, especially of Maas, Maarten, Zeeman, Channel Me, and me, in the JavaScript land and how to get Erlang communicating, Zotonic communicating in a fluent way with browsers and how to get everything running in the browser. So, when we were visiting the browser, it was quite interesting for us because this in the browser, everything, all the components are in state-of-the-art JavaScript land. Everything is combined into a big blob of code, compiled, they say, but it's just essentially concatenated. And everything is in one namespace, in a single thread running, and it is a kind of cooperative multitasking, but these huge projects are running in the browser. Coming from Erlang, of course, that was a bit weird, to say the least. So we looked into it, and we immediately felt like there are two major problems here. Now, immediately, not really immediately, but now that we are getting a bit more advanced. And one of the problems is the privacy of the data. The other is the isolation of the code itself, which we always get with Erlang easily. So let's see. First, take a look at the privacy of data. So all the JavaScript code is running in one big namespace. And that means all code can access all data. You can also access the DOM, that's the HTML you see on the screen. Every routine in the UI thread has full access to everything, which is not really ideal. They also have full access to what you call the local and the session storage inside the browser, where you can basically keep all kinds of secrets and data, which is also not kind of ideal when you are combining all those components from all those different sources. You ideally want to isolate the code. Because you don't want code to share this namespace and overwriting each other's data, or by accident or on purpose, or share resources that you have to wait for each other or get in all kinds of race conditions. And you also don't want code to block the UI thread, as they call it in the browser, where the browser is doing all the work to get stuff on your screen. And actually, we found that there is a very good solution to all that. It's called DevWorkers. It's around for a long time, quite a long time now in the browsers, but still mentioned as kind of state of the art when you want to do some rendering or video or whatever. But basically, this big processes you can split off as preemptive multitasking, which is great. That is the kind of stuff that we like. It is an isolated execution environment. They only communicate with the browser via message passing. Hey, that is something we are used to as Erlang programmers. And surprise, Maas Maarten, he tried it on his phone and was able to start literally hundreds of web workers on his phone. So I thought, then this is something that is really useful. But can we really use it? looking at the Can I Use, that is really one of the greatest websites when you're using, when you're programming for the web. Yes, we can use. This is this Opera Mini, but yeah, that's something everybody ignores anyway. All browsers support this. So that is really the way to go. Put in your code into web workers. But that gives us immediately another problem. We have to communicate the stuff. So we have to wire everything up so that we can reach the code that's running in the web workers, reach the UI, etc. So they need to talk to each other. Before it was easy, there are this one big namespace, or just call each other. Now it gets a bit harder. So let's look, let's take a look at how web sites, applications are communicating. First, what everybody does is like a client-server request, API calls. Just give me this data, do this, give me the return, etc., etc., etc. That is really the thing that maybe 50 to 80% of all websites are still using at the moment, even when they are so-called advanced. When we are mixing in our web workers, then we also need to have communication not just with the server, we also need to communicate with the web worker and back. And ideally, we also want to have the server pushing data to the client. And when we're at it, it would be nice to be able to be from client A, go via the server to client B and back. Or from one client to another client in the service worker. When you're running in the same on the same computer, you have a service worker running, you can communicate with each other. And really, like what we would like to do, see in the near future, and we have been running experiments with that, we'd like to use WebRTC to really communicate directly from one client to another client on different systems, with a fallback, of course, for client server client. All this, when you look at solutions in the field, they all is a mixed match of different protocols, methods, etc., etc., etc. But it would be nice if we would be able to have all this running and unified on a, yeah, one single communication bus. So we don't need to talk different protocols, different methods. We don't have this mismatch. We can just talk. All parts, all components can just talk. So like in this little graph, we have the components on the left-hand side, components on the page. They are either working in web workers. Some are maybe working on the, in the UI thread because they need access to the DOM. And on the other side, we have like a server with a database, a whole Internet of Things stuff that is running. We just want to combine and connect them. And there is a solution. There is something that is possible to use for all this. That was something we had packed in a corner of Photonic before, and that's MQTT. That is a communication protocol that's used for Internet of Things. It is completely standardized, all kinds of hubs for your lights, etc. Also to use for MQTT. It uses topic trees that can be as deep as you want with wildcards like the plus for single level and the number sign for any level afterwards. And can have anything as a payload. Can also put binary data in there or JSON, you call it, serialized Erlang terms, also possible. And in the newest version, the version 5, it has even metadata, so we can put like extra headers in it. Great stuff, works excellent, it's a standard, works everywhere. So we've been looking, okay, how can we use this MQTT, because it is a solution that is standard, we don't need to think, we don't need reinvent wheels, how can we use it? So first, we have to wire up in the client. We have to wire up those web workers to everything. So give them a communication bus to work on. So we added a topic tree with a broker. Broker is the thing that sends messages for the topic tree, publish, subscribe, inside the client, inside the browser. all the web workers are basically clients to this one topic tree. And we said put a broker for each site running on the server on the other side. And then the client, the web browser, connects as a client to the server broker. Then we have like two topic trees. So we need to connect them together. And for connecting them together, we are building a bridge. A bridge, let's first look from the client to the server, communication client to the server. So if you want to publish something on the client, you publish to bridge / origin / some topic, some server topic. Origin is of course the name that is used in JavaScript land for the place where the website came from, for the server it came from. Could be anything else as well. Of course, you can have multiple bridges. The bridge itself, being subscribed to a wildcard, takes this server-side topic, foo / bar in this case, and republishes this message on the server. So in this way, a web worker can easily publish something to the broker in the client. The broker in the client routes it through the bridge, and the bridge republishes on the server. So suddenly our web worker can reach the server, any topic on the server. The other way around also works. So we add a client, a bridge on the server. We give every client, we give a unique client ID, again, wildcard. And in this case, we translate to hello world, just the client topic, and publish on the client broker, which works very convenient. So from the server, we can just do a publish to the client. No problem at all anymore, if we know unique client ID, of course. So if you make a picture, then it's this little overview. So you have like two browsers or two computers. The green and the yellow one are the same one. There you see also a little arrow in between. That is that horizontal arrow is the service worker being able to make it possible that they can communicate directly to each other without having a server in between or WebRTC. Then we have the server, of course, it connects everything together. And because it is MQTT, because it is a standard, we can also add Internet of Things devices or other machines connect to the server and route messages to everything, to everywhere, to every client. Now, we have a very small example of this whole setup. Let's look at this one. We have here in Cotonic org, we have a small chat application, because chat is the killer demonstration that everybody is using anyway. And then we have here on this MQTT Explorer. So we are connecting here to Cotonic topic. So let's connect. So we are connected and we have here our chat running. This chat is connected to, not to Zotonic, but to the public MQTT Eclipse.org broker. That is just everybody's using that one for demonstration. And when we type something here, then we see that there is here this subject, this topic with our little message. So now we see that with our JavaScript, we can actually connect bridge, this is the bridge in working, to any MQTT broker that has a WebSocket connection. Let's go back to where we are. So this gives already great flexibility. We are not just only possible to connect to Zotonic or only to a certain kind of server. Because it is a standard, we can use all kinds of brokers. But it gives us other possibilities. So on the server, we have made possible, because of this unified bus, we actually unified it also on the server. So suddenly we can everything connect everything together. We have also the HTTP API, which is just a topic. We have the JavaScript broker in templates on the server. We have just that this is just shorthand M instead of model. And even on HTML publish, just click on an anchor and it will post a message to a topic. So everything gets wired up together. And to have a little sidestep to the server, it is even easy now on the server, on Zotonic, to make a model, add your functions, the exports, and you are sitting on this same bus. You are sitting on this bus, you immediately have an HTTP API, an MQTT API, and immediately are available in the templates, which is just great stuff to see happening. Yeah. And super simple to build. So now we have hooked everything up together. We have hooked all the models in the Zotonic server, with all the web workers, with all the clients, with all the Internet of Things devices. Just name it. We have hooked everything up together in one big namespace, one big topic tree with some bridges to route everything together. That is, of course, a bit of a problem. Because of security, we want to limit who can publish to what, who can reach what information. So we need access control. And it also gives a problem that, of course, the server, all those brokers can snoop on the data that is passed along. So we want to secure that. So I want to give first a very short view on how we are protecting for the access control, the topics. So if a client connects to the server, we give not just a client ID, that is normal MQTT, we give also a routing ID. The client ID is kind of secret. You can call it a session ID. And the routing ID is more like a public address. You can do so. If the client receives a message on its client ID, it says, oh, everything is secure, everything is checked, the server checked this, I can just believe that this message is really meant for me and not coming from some strange party. If a client receives a message on its via routing ID, via the bridge with the routing ID, then it says, this could come from anywhere. So it's like public data. It could be somebody who just connected to my system and is just sending me random information. So it can only be connected to the public and the response topics that are available. The bridge on the client keeps this in check. Then the server side. And we connect, we can use a username password as usual in MQTT, or we use an authentication cookie. In Zotonic, we use an authentication cookie because the authentication cookie is really secure. The MQTT session uses the authentication cookie to act in the name of the user, so it logs on to the system. And then we check every publish and every subscribe, we check against the access control modules. So we can really very granularly say, oh, this user is allowed to do this, that user is allowed to do that. And then when you get into your models or other subscribers, they actually receive a request context that's authenticated with the sending user. So it can do another check if this user is really allowed to receive this information. Is this user allowed to see the title of this resource or this page? Is the user allowed to update this page? That kind of checks should be done in the model again. So we have a very granular, very specific access control possibility in the server. Then there's this payload problem. If you're passing around a username and a password. You don't want everybody looking at the username password. You want really to be able to encrypt it in the payload. And there is a problem with payload encryption on like MQTT systems, and that is that you don't know with whom you are talking. So you're just publishing on some topic, and there's some subscriber receiving it, but you don't know who the subscriber is. So this public-private key encryption is not really possible. So for that, we are adding a key server. This is a trusted component. You have to trust somebody with all those end-to-end encryption that you have in all kind of like WhatsApp, etc. You also just trust WhatsApp that they are not lying about all the certificates. So you have to always trust somebody, something or somebody, in this case the key server. And the client registers out of band with this key server and some handshakes, blah blah blah, to gain trust. And then the client can ask for an encryption key at the key server. Receives an encryption key with a key ID. And then when we publish a message, we encrypt it with the encryption key. We tag it with the key ID. We publish it. And then the subscribers receive the message, sees it encrypted with this key ID. And then we'll request the key server like, oh, I see that it's encrypted with this key ID. Can I receive the encryption key? The key server will then decide if it's okay to share this encryption key with the subscriber, the receiver of the message, or not. Also in this setup, we are making it possible that we have multiple key servers that are working together, so that you can just go to your own key server with this key ID and request your information. They should communicate together to share the key and et cetera, so it's the sender and the receiver in the end have the same key. So this is basically what we built, what we made. So we have now a really nice communication structure with all kind of components that work together, that are communicating on a single bus, and that are able to encrypt even their messages, the payloads, so that we have also very secure communication. All this stuff is open source. Sotonic is of course open source. Cotonic is open source. We will be making those into packages for NPM or whatever. We built our own MQTT V5 version 5 encoder decoder because it was not available when we were building this, and we also need some flexibility. And this one is encoding decoding into maps, and this backwards compatible with all the protocols. And we have also a session manager made because we need advanced throttling and advanced access control, and that is possible with our own session manager that will also be able to drop messages and have a bit more knowledge about what kind of stuff is passing by. But it is just a component you can use in any airline project. And we have our little topic tree router. That is a very simple router. Use edge tables and use a tree. And it's very efficient. We made this together with subsidies from the SDM funds and MIT R&D. Without them, it was really not possible. Channel Me is working very hard to this, and Learning Stone and Dreambit are supporting this and will also be using this technology pretty soon. So we are at the questions, if there are any.
And before, big hand, a virtual hand, a real hand, your preference of the emojis and stuff on Zoom. So Mark, this is really awesome, and thanks for doing all the work and you know, open sourcing it and bringing it to the community. And you're absolutely right, never walk alone. You can get if you want to go fast, go alone. If you want to go far, go together. So this is a great example of that. You're growing the community by helping us all with this. So I'm going to take a quick look at Hova now to see if we have any questions there. Not yet. So then I'm going to leave the floor open for questions, because we have a little time for questions. We have a lot of people in the audience, and we always know that it's a bit tricky to go first. So maybe I'll start with one question. I'm thinking, what did you find? What was your biggest learning or insight or biggest surprise while doing this? Could you elaborate a bit on that, please?
Our biggest surprise was actually this one method of routing, this uniform method, enables it to. So suddenly we wrote in a couple of lines of airline code, we wrote a model to read the session storage of a client. That was like an eye opener, like, wow, we can just have a model running in the browser, and then we can not only access it in the browser, we can access it from the server. And then Maas said, oh, it can go further. Just try it from the command line. Oh yeah, we can access the client from the command line. So it gives us all kinds of possibilities to look into the client. And that is also great for like help desk people, because we can now suddenly see what's going on in the client. And that was something nobody could dream of before. So it was really, really nice.
Cool. Thanks for sharing. More questions or comments or reflections or maybe contribution proposals or feature requests, or now you have the chance.
Actually, we have also requests as developers. We would love people trying it out. And we are now working together with going to work together with some experienced JavaScript people also to start the packaging. And we would love to have feedback also on the Cotonic stuff we are building. How it can be useful as in combination with other frameworks. And we just encourage to use all the components we are making anyway. If as Cotonic, we are quite a big project. We have tens and tens and tens and tens of different components, different sub-projects we are managing. And sometimes when people find something useful, we also split another project off. So if anybody sees something, hey, that is a useful part, but it's now inside this huge code base, is it possible to split it off? And just ask, because we can and actually are doing that kind of splitting off of code.